Okay, so thanks everyone and welcome back. Today we have Aidan Chapman-Davies, who's going to talk about cosmological decoherence from thermal gravitons. Aidan, thank you very much for giving this talk, and take it away.
All right. So first off, thank you very much for the invitation to do this. It's a pleasure to give the talk, and all the more so to do this virtually. This is an exciting experience, and the technology I can get behind. So. Right, so without further ado, I guess I'll get started. So today, I'd like to tell you about a little bit of work that I did together with Ning Bao, Jason Pollock, and Grant Remen. If I use my mouse, can you see me pointing stuff out on my slides?
You can point with the mouse.
Okay, great, yeah, so, right. So I'll talk a little bit about some work where the archive reference is down here. And the title of the work, both the work and this talk, is gonna be Cosmological Decoherence from Thermal Gravitons. All right, so let's get started. So I'll begin with a little bit of an introduction because the talk is about cosmological decoherence due to thermal gravitons. So I'll start with, what was that?
I don't know, maybe somebody.
Oh, you know, that's probably my email client. I'm just gonna close my email so it's not making sounds. Right. Okay, so the talk is about cosmological decoherence due to thermal gravitons. So I'll begin with an introduction that covers those three keywords. So let's talk first a little bit about decoherence. So you might remember from towards the end of your quantum mechanics classes as an undergraduate, you heard this word decoherence. And when I say decoherence, what I mean is the loss of purity in some quantum system due to entanglement with an unmonitored environment. Okay, so instead of giving just the formal definition, I find it's best just, I'll just start with an example that illustrates really just all the key features of the decoherence and what we're gonna need for this talk, namely the dephasing channel, okay? So, all right, so what is a dephasing channel? So let's start with some Hilbert space, H, which admits a tensor factorization to two parts, so HS and HE, which I'm suggestively labeling for system and environment. And suppose that dimension of the HS factor is just two, so it has two configurations, and dimension of HE is it's some very large number. It doesn't really matter what it is, but some large Hilbert space, okay? And now suppose that in addition to this Hilbert space, it comes with some interactions, which behave as follows, such that if you start in the first state of the system, tensored with some zero state of the environment, it evolves with very large probability, it just stays the same, but then with some small probability, P, it evolves into the state one system, one environment, okay? Or if we start in state two of the system, and again, state zero of the environment, again, with some large probability, one minus P, it just remains, the state remains unchanged, but with some small probability, P, it evolves into the state two, and now the environment evolves into a different orthogonal state two environment, okay? And you can think of this as like a toy model maybe for like, say some photon that's coming from the CMB that's bouncing off of a rock, all right? So maybe the rock, these two system states are the position wave function of some rock that can be centered around position x1 or x2, and the environment here is some photon that comes along. Most of the time, the photon starts in state zero, just sails on through, doesn't interact, but every once in a while, okay, if the rock's in position one, the photon interacts with this rock, is now sent into the state one environment, or if the rock's in position two, sent into the state two environment, okay? So, right, just some toy model for interactions between a system and an environment, all right? So now, let's look at the action of the dephasing channel. In particular, let's suppose that our system starts in a superposition of the two system states, one and two, okay? And the environment starts in this zero ready state. So now, after a little bit of math, it's not too hard, you can work out that after one interaction, the reduced state of the system will look like this. It looks almost like the initial state, except for, so it has the same diagonal components, but now the off-diagonals, the size of the off-diagonal components have been reduced by a factor of one minus p, okay? So then after many interactions, as number of interactions asymptotes to infinity, provided we can keep reusing this environment, the state of the system evolves to just a diagonal density matrix with nothing on the off diagonals, okay? So this interaction causes the state of the system to decohere into this one and two basis, all right? Which the technical term for this is the pointer basis, the basis into which the system decoheres, okay? So really, that's all that, this is really all that we're going to need about decoherence for this talk. It's really just the loss of purity of some system due to interaction with an unmonitored environment. Okay. I'll just make a couple of notes. Note that decoherence, it depends on the initial state. So if we'd only started in the one state, I mean, there wouldn't really be any meaningful sense in which the system is decohering because it just remains diagonal for all time. And it also depends on having low initial entanglement with the environment, because this is a dynamical process. And also on that point too, really, you really need to have the right interactions between the system and environment for you to have decoherence, because it's a dynamical process. Okay. I'll note, please interrupt me if ever you have questions, if you want to clarify anything. I'll just take questions as they come and proceed. But anyways, maybe show of hands for how many people are very comfortable with decoherence? Raise your hand. I can see you, so. Yeah, how many people are pretty comfortable with decoherence? Okay, yeah, good. How many people have written papers about decoherence? Okay, that's fine. So anyways, but okay, I think we're all on the same page. Right. So the talk's about decoherence due to thermal gravitons. So, well, okay, why are we gonna be thinking about gravitons? Well, for one, they couple universally, okay? And you can't screen them. Well, at least without implausible physical side effects, without violating some energy conditions in very serious ways, okay? So what this means is that interactions with gravitons, provided you're not monitoring the gravitons, which we aren't really, unless you're LIGO and you monitor a very huge number of gravitons, this means that gravitons are an environment in any physical process, and they provide a universal floor for the decoherence rate in any physical system of interest, right? But wait, you might say, aren't gravitational interactions desperately weak? And where do these gravitons come from anyway? Like, why should we be thinking about this? So to address those two questions, I'd now like to come to the third word in my talk title, namely cosmology, all right? And so now, if we think in cosmological settings, the timescales are long enough for interesting things to happen when your processes are driven by very weak interactions, such as gravitational interactions. And if you have a cosmology that has a positive cosmological constant, then you have a thermal bath of gravitons supplied to you by your cosmic horizon, okay? So the conclusion that I want to draw from just these very kind of arguments is that over cosmological timescales, thermal gravitons are going to drive gravitational decoherence. And the aim of this talk is to investigate this conclusion, all right? So let's investigate this. So the setup for this talk, it's going to be, kind of like the easiest gravitational system coupled to matter that you can imagine. We're just going to look at a scalar field coupled to graphene, okay? So I'm really just going to be considering a scalar field described by the following action. So the usual thing, you have the gravitational sector, and then you have some scalar field that propagates some potential via phi. And the coupling to gravity is entirely going to be through this metric measure in the integration, all right? And we're going to suppose that the potential for the scalar field has the following qualitative shape, okay? So we're going to suppose that it has some potential minima. For this talk, let's just suppose there's two minima in the potential, okay? And let's suppose that they sit at positive values of the potential, all right? So that classically, at least, if you have this potential, there are stable states where the scalar field just sits in one of these two minima, and the field sitting in that minimum in either of those minima would source a positive cosmological constant, okay? And it would just give you a de Sitter solution. All right, but as we all know, or as we would naturally expect, quantum mechanically, such a situation becomes unstable with respect to tunneling transitions. All right, so if you have instead a quantum state of some field that's peaked around the initial vacuum, then quantum mechanically, of course, there's some amplitude that you can tunnel through this potential barrier to arrive at the lower potential. Okay. These processes will proceed at some decay rate per unit volume, which has the general qualitative form shown as follows. So just some prefactor times and an exponentially suppressing term. And the exponential suppression factor, it depends on the sort of transition you're looking at. Two very prominent transitions that we can think of, or two such tunneling transitions we can think of, are the Coleman-DeLucia process, where basically you start at this larger potential minimum. I'll call this the false vacuum, and you just tunnel down to the lower potential minimum. Another tunneling transition you could think about would be Hawking-Moss transitions, where instead you tunnel to the top of this hill in between the two potentials, and then classically roll down to the other potential minimum. But in either case, just the take-home message from this is that it's a tunneling process, and it proceeds at some exponentially suppressed rate. Generally, an exponentially suppressed rate that depends on this separation between the two values of potential. Okay. Right. So that's vacuum decay. And the goal today, more or less, is going to be to study the rate at which superpositions of field configurations decohere due to interactions with a thermal graviton bath. Okay, so what you should have in mind is that we're going to be comparing like the rates at which gravitational decoherence proceeds to the rate at which you can make these cosmological phase transitions on cosmic timescales. All right, so that's the overall goal. And before jumping into the more technical and nitty-gritty details, let's just do a very quick back-the-envelope calculation to get a handle on this gravitational decoherence. Okay, so the decoherence rate should depend on the graviton bath temperature. Okay. And it probably also should depend on the energy difference in the superposition that you're trying to, that you're preparing, that you're subjecting, or that's being subjected to this graviton bath, okay? And so if we look at the decoherence rate, roughly it should go faster the higher the temperature is, and it should also go faster the larger your energy separation between the two states you're trying to superpose is. It shouldn't care what the sign of the energy difference is, so it's probably a delta E squared. And to make the units work out, well, there's probably a factor of M Planck in the denominator here, okay? So, right, so this is our kind of rough physical intuition of how this should proceed. So let's now cast this in terms of the field, properties of the field. So if we take our potential, D of phi, and now it's expanded about phi plus, so the higher potential, so locally, it looks like some quadratic function. Let's be loose about the units for the time being, and let's just think about homogeneous fields, simplify things. Then, in that case, if we have some field that's centered sitting around this higher potential minimum, fluctuations in energy, they're going to scale something like this quadratic term here, right? So delta E is going to go like V prime prime around phi plus times delta phi square, okay? And say we have some Gaussian profile for our field. Then if you recall like, so what a wave function for a Gaussian field looks like, you'd remember that, okay, well, this delta phi squared, then it goes like 1/√ V prime prime. Okay, so overall this means that we should expect the decoherence rate to go something like temperature of the graviton bath times the second derivative of the potential at phi plus divided by M Planck squared. And you can check, okay, units work out this expression. So, having expressed this in terms of field parameters, let's now go one step further and express this decoherence rate in terms of cosmological parameters. So, to that end, let's perform a suggestive rewriting of this potential. So, okay, we have this V of phi, we've expanded it around the false vacuum. Now let's just write this first term as the effective cosmological constant with the right dimensional factor, plus then 1/2 some parameter of the field that has dimensions of mass times phi squared, where I'm just calling this difference here, this script phi. So in terms of these quantities, we find that this decoherence rate proceeds like, so the temperature of the graviton bath, it goes like square root of the effective cosmological constant times some field parameter that has dimensions of mass divided by the mass Planck squared, okay? Or in other words, really just kind of get to the end of the day message, this decoherence, the time for decoherence, the typical time scale in which gravitational decoherence driven by gravitons occurs, goes like some number times the Hubble time, okay? So, the Hubble time goes like 1/√ lambda. So I've just inverted this expression here. So, okay, so take home message is that, well, this is the decoherence time is parametrically longer than the Hubble time, but it's not exponentially longer. So already you should expect that, okay, this is going to have something, this could have something to do with cosmological phase transitions that happen on exponentially long times in terms of the Hubble time, okay? So that was my introduction. I'll just pause here to ask, are there any questions that anyone would like to ask, comments? Yes, no?
I see. None here in Boston.
Okay, great. So in that case, I'll proceed and let's proceed with the talk, which is basically going to be taking this back-of-the-envelope calculation, and we're going to make it a little bit more precise. So let's start by talking about gravitational decoherence. All right, so let's come back to our starting point, this action for a scalar field coupled to gravity, and let's introduce some gravitons into the picture, okay? So to do that, we're going to take our metric, g mu nu, and let's write it as some background metric that I'm denoting by g bar of mu nu, plus now the small fluctuation part, which is our gravitons, h mu, okay? So what you can do is you can take that, you can just plug that expansion for g mu nu into the action, and you find that your action you can split it into three parts. You can split it into an action for the scalar field phi. So here our scalar field is going to be the system, plus an action that's purely for the gravitons. And the gravitons, these are going to be our environment. And then there's some interaction term that involves both gravitons and the scalar field. Okay. And I've just written these out here. The exact form of this, it's not too important for the talk, but more just, it's, I don't know, if you've seen this before, this should look familiar. This should look familiar for the scalar field. The action for the gravitons, once, okay, I've added in an extra great gauge fixing term to make it look pretty, but it's just the normal action that you know and love for gravitons. And then there's some interaction term that couples gravitons to the scalar field, where in this expression here, you can manifestly see the gravitons, the H terms, and the scalar field is wrapped up in this stress energy tensor T, okay, as well as this tensor U, but it's, again, details aren't super, super important. U is just a function of the stress energy tensor of the scalar field. All right, so for decoherence, you know what we have to do? We have a system and environment. We then have to trace out, we want to look at the evolution of the system according to the total Hamiltonian, then trace out the environment. So having introduced the gravitons, now let's just get rid of the gravitons, all right? So schematically, our program is to just write down a Schrodinger equation for the whole system and trace over the graviton sector, okay? So just again, very schematically, what this involves is starting with some initial density matrix for the field and gravitons, evolving it forward using the full dynamics of the system and environment, and then integrating out over the gravitons, okay? So now we're gonna start making some approximations, and I'm gonna make some comments here. So preempting some future approximations that are gonna come, I'm gonna specialize to now the case where the background metric is just a flat metric, okay? And I'm gonna assume now that the state of the gravitons is just some thermal distribution, okay? So some static thermal distribution. All right, and with these approximations, you can then turn the non-equilibrium field theory crank, grind through the full machinery, which I thank Malcolm Blanco and then Kelsa Dunhu for enlightening literature on the subject. When you do so, just at the end of the day, the final output is a master equation for the scalar field density matrix, okay? So let's dissect this expression just a little bit. I'll draw your attention to what the important and interesting parts are of this equation. So rho here is a density matrix for the scalar field sector. And its evolution, it looks like, okay, there's a part that just looks like a normal Schrodinger evolution, so a commutator with a Hamiltonian. And then you have now this dissipative part, which is the term that's going to give you the effect of non-unitary evolution in just the field sector, and which ultimately drives decoherence, okay? So important parts of this extra factor here, you'll notice it has two overall terms. There's this real noise term, which is driven by noise kernel, which is, so just some spectral integral featuring prominently this factor n of k, which this is where the thermality, the assumption of graviton thermality enters into the calculation. This n of k is the Bose-Einstein distribution. You have the second imaginary part, which is called, driven by this term, which is called dissipation kernel. This will be less important for the analysis. And maybe the last thing I'd like to draw your attention to, because it will be interesting for some future discussion, is this tensor structure that appears in the two terms here. Namely, you have this T mu nu contraction minus T mu nu product here, which appears in both lines. And we'll draw some interesting physics later. But anyway, so take home messages: when you start with a scalar field coupled to gravitons, integrate out the gravitons, you wind up with a master equation for the scalar field, which looks like, okay, normal Schrodinger evolution, and then some dissipative part, okay? Any questions? No? Okay, good. I will keep going then. So, right, that's gravitational decoherence, sparing you a lot of the calculational details. So let's take this now, and let's apply this machinery to cosmology, all right? So now let's make some simplifying assumptions, because otherwise, up until now, it's been fully general, but that's gonna be way too hard to actually extract some meaningful physics from, so let's simplify a bit, okay? So first things first, for this calculation, we're just gonna restrict the zero mode of the field, okay? So we're gonna drop all other modes of the field, just look at homogeneous field configurations. And furthermore, let's also consider just a field in some finite ball B of volume V, okay? Just to regulate the integrals and dispense with nasty functional analysis, okay? And so the picture that you should have in mind is that what we're going to be studying now are we're going to be studying a ball of a scalar field in that we want now prepare a superposition of field values. And we're going to ask, okay, well, how does this behave now when you couple it to a thermal bath and gravitons? Okay. Now, let's maybe relate this picture just a little bit more to cosmology. If we think back to our original cosmological setup, you should think of this as kind of like a very crude model for bubble nucleation of true vacuum inside a false vacuum. Okay, so if you'll recall how the Coleman Delitzsch process example proceeds, if you start in some cosmology with the higher value of the cosmological constant, okay, so some fields sitting at the higher value potential, the way this decay proceeds is by nucleating a little bubble of the true vacuum, which is a net zero energy process, which then goes on to expand and fill up your space-time with the true vacuum of lower cosmological constant, okay? So, right, so we kind of want to think of this as being like a toy model for, you have some background space-time, which is in a superposition of both true vacuum and false vacuum, so this little region which has a bubble that's in superposition of true vacuum and false vacuum, and how does gravitational decoherence due to interactions with gravitons play with this? But now, so let me make some remarks. If we call the size of the ball L in our toy model, then you should think of this ball size L as being like the bubble radius of this Coleman-Delitzsch bubble, okay? And now if the separation between the two values of the potential is much smaller than the mean value of the potential between these two vacua, then your bubble radius will be much smaller than the Hubble radius in either configuration. And so this justifies this approximation we're making where we're just considering an approximately flat background, okay? So this bubble is much smaller than your curvature scale. Physics is gonna look approximately flat. So I just wanted to comment on that to hopefully just convince you that this is a reasonable thing to do to look at an approximately flat background. Okay, so having made some simplifying assumptions, let's also make an unsimplifying assumption. So we've restricted to the zero mode of the field and we're looking at a finite ball B of volume V to regulate some integrals. Instead of just looking at a scalar field, let's look at a cosmic fluid that has an equation of state parameter W, okay? Why do we want to do this? Well, because we can at very little computational cost. It's going to reveal some interesting physics too. And if we want, we can always plug in an equation of state parameter W equals minus one to go back to the homogeneous scalar field configuration, okay? So operationally and calculationally, what that's going to mean for this discussion is that the stress energy tensor for this now cosmic fluid is going to take the following form. It's going to be some energy density phi times now a diagonal matrix. I'm working in four dimensions, but just for convenience, but we could work in any number of space-time dimensions. And here I'm separating this out just to really indicate that and I'm putting hats here explicitly to indicate where I'm going to absorb operator dependence. So the parts that really are the Hilbert space parts of the expressions and where I'm going to absorb tensorial space-time dependence, okay? So in particular, I'm going to absorb all of the Hilbert space operator dependence into this energy density. And then, right, there'll be just some tensorial space-time dependence multiplying it, okay? So for example, this also means that the Hamiltonian is just going to be given by the volume of the ball times this energy density, where, again, we're absorbing operator dependence into the energy density, all right? Okay, good. So we've made some assumptions. We've set up some machinery. So now let's plug this all into the master equation that we started with in the first place. And now you wind up with something that is much, much more tractable than the fully general case that I showed you a few slides ago, okay? So it all boils down to just one line. So we have our evolution for the density matrix of the scalar field is given by just this normal Schrodinger equation part, commutator with what was the Hamiltonian. And the noise and dissipation kernel parts now boil down into this nice compact form here, okay? Where there's an overall numerical prefactor, which I call F of W. This is just coming from the tensor structure that I highlighted a little bit earlier, okay? So just some numerical factor that depends on the equation of state parameter or a cosmic fluid. And then there's some operator dependence. So this energy density, both commutator and anti-commutator in the two parts with the scalar field density matrix. And we have integrated noise and dissipation kernels, which we have now which is now simplified, integrated up because of this ball assumption and homogeneity of the scalar field assumption. Okay, great. So we have an evolution equation for a density matrix. What do we do now? Let's actually look at some quantum mechanical system. All right, so to that end, I'm going to ask you to consider essentially a cosmic two-level system. So now in principle, we could look at any number or even a continuum of energy densities, but the physics is more or less the same. And so for simplicity, let's just consider two values of the energy density of our cosmic fluid, okay? We're just going to call them phi1 and phi2, all right? So really, this is going to be a cosmic two-level system. This operator, this energy density operator phi, in the energy density eigenbasis, just looks like a 2x2 matrix with the energy densities on the diagonal. And our scalar field density matrix now is just going to be the density matrix of a two-level system, giving you amplitudes, quantum amplitudes, to be in a ball of cosmic fluid of energy density 1 or a ball of cosmic fluid of energy density 2, okay? So then you can take this cosmic two-level system, plug it into the master equation, and you find the following. So you find that the master equation, just the evolution equation for the diagonal terms is trivial, just says, okay, at least to this order and approximation, the diagonal terms remain unchanged. However, the off-diagonal terms do have non-trivial and interesting evolution, which, as you might have expected, depends on these noise and dissipation kernels and depends on a difference in the energy densities of this cosmic fluid, okay? Right, so now the name of the game is we want to look at how this interaction of gravitons drives decoherence. So we want to look at the evolution of these off-diagonal terms and look at how they decay as a function of time. All right, so we can solve this. We can solve this equation of motion for the off-diagonal components of the two-level system density matrix. So here I've just written it again. And we're interested in long-time behavior, so what we can do is we can take these integrated noise and dissipation kernels and plug in their asymptotic behavior as t grows very large, okay? So taking these expressions, plugging them into this equation motion, we can make an ansatz for the off-diagonal terms, just as some exponential function that has a decaying part and some rotating term. Making that ansatz, plugging it in, you find that this parameter lambda is given by the following expression, looks like kappa squared. So remember, kappa is just up to constants to reduce Planck mass. Kappa squared times L cubed. L cubed is the size of our ball, divided by the inverse temperature, times this numerical factor that depends on the equation of state parameter, times the energy density difference between the two fluid configurations that we're looking at squared. Okay, and the omega factor, it's not super important. Again, it just has a bunch of it just depends on the parameters of the problem. But really the important thing is this parameter lambda, because this lambda here is going to be the parameter that tells you how fast the off-diagonal components of the scalar field density matrix are decaying away. Okay. So right, so now we're in a position where we can...
I have a question. Can you remind us once again, like, what was N and D?
Could you repeat that, please?
Can you remind us once again what was tilde N and tilde D?
Oh yeah, right. So tilde N and tilde D, these are just integrated forms of the noise and dissipation kernels, where they've been regulated by our assumption that we're just our space is now has finite volume, and it originally comes from the master equation that we started with by starting with the full action for the scalar field and gravitons, expanding to linear order in H bar, then integrating with the gravitons. It's these terms here driving the dissipative evolution. That's where it came from.
So the factors of beta come from there?
Yeah, so the factors of beta come from the fact that the assumption of thermality of the gravitons is baked into the expressions for N and D. So you see originally this capital N of R and T, it has a Bose-Einstein spectral factor in there, which contains the temperature of the gravitons.
Wait, so only the noise term is temperature dependent, not the dissipation term, or what's in your
calculus? Yes, that's correct.
Is that because both these pieces come from graviton? So how do you what's the intuition behind splitting one to the other, or is it literally that the temperature dependence is what you call noise and everything else is what you call dissipation? Like what's the physics in terms of how you made this split? And
I don't have a good answer for that. I don't have an intuitive answer myself. But I think what you're saying is more or less right. That like, a posteriori, you can understand the split from the fact that this noise term is ultimately going to be the thing that's driving your decoherence. And so perhaps comes as no surprise that this is the term that's really dependent on the temperature of the gravitons. Whereas the dissipation term, this is just causing rotation. Rotation of the phase of the off-diagonal terms of the density matrix, and so it just depends on the tensorial nature of the gravitons that are coupling to the scalar field.
Oh, I see, because it has the factor of I there. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Sorry, I also have another question. Can you return to the slide that you were just showing?
This one?
No, sorry, where you were defining the noise, yeah, that one.
Oh, yes.
So is there an intuitive way to see why the noise should be coupled to these commutators and the dissipation kernel to these anti-commutation kernels? Or is it something that you understand a posteriori when you've done the calculations, basically what you were just showing us before the questions?
Yeah, so again, I don't have a good physical intuitive explanation to give beyond the fact that like, well, when you grind through the non-equilibrium field theory, this is how it crops out.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. But at the end of the day, actually, at least in the case of the homogeneous scalar field, the commutators and anti-commutators don't end up making a huge difference. What really ends up making the big difference is this factor F and W, which comes from the tensorial structure that's going in there. These contractions of T mu nu ends up being what's important. You can see that that tensorial factor in the case of the homogeneous scalar field just comes out and becomes decoupled from this Hilbert space structure of commutators and anti-commutators.
So remind me, W equals 1 was the case that we had before where you,
W equals minus 1 would be the pure scalar field.
Right.
W equals 0 would be like cosmic dust. W equals 1/3, that'd be a radiation fluid. But yeah, you could look at some continuum of, we just say parameters. Yeah. Okay. Right, so now we can study the decay of decoherence. So we have the off-diagonal components of this density matrix. They're going to decay at a rate set by this parameter lambda, which again, so depends on the volume. So volume of our system divided by inverse temperature. So it scales like the temperature of our system. There's this equation of state parameter and the difference in energy densities. Okay. So we see that indeed, this formalism, it describes decoherence into the phi 1, phi 2 basis, provided that lambda is greater than 0, okay? So if lambda is greater than 0, this is then a decaying exponential. So if we look at all the parameters that compute lambda, so kappa, L, and beta, these are all manifestly positive. We have a squared difference of energy densities. This is also manifestly positive. So lambda is greater than 0, provided that F of W is greater than 0. Okay, and F of W is just a quadratic polynomial in the equation of state parameter. You can work out that this F of W is greater than 0, provided that W lies within this range, okay, from minus 0.15 to about 2.15, okay. You'll immediately notice that W equals minus 1 is not in this range, so hold that thought. But at least for the time being, if W is in that range, then decoherence happens more or less how one would expect, okay? And so now let's just go one last final step to make contact with our back of the envelope calculation. If we just rewrite beta just as the inverse temperature, if we write, multiply the energy density, phi j, by the volume of the ball, you can write that as the energy of your ball. And if we call one over root g, well, okay, recall that one over root g is just the unreduced Planck mass. You can re-express this decay parameter lambda as just T over 4 times this F of W times, exactly as we expected, a difference in energies divided by a Planck mass all squared, okay? So after a fairly lengthy involved calculation, we recover what we expected just from the easy, simple back-the-envelope calculation right at the end, all right? So that's the case where everything proceeds as we'd expect, but you must be wondering, well, okay, what about the case when W is less than minus 0.15, okay? So you could make all these conclusions without changing basis, but I find it's illuminating to go to a new basis. So I'm gonna define this new basis, psi one, psi two, as a superposition. Each one is a superposition of the definite field value states, okay? And when you do so, you can rewrite the density matrix for the cosmic fluid in the following form. Okay, and if you stare at this, say just look at this upper left term in the density matrix, it's maybe not too hard to convince yourself that, okay, once lambda t is larger than log 1 over absolute value of the initial value of the off-diagonal elements in the original basis, this density matrix stops being positive definite, okay? So what it's indicating is that at this stage, the master equation approximation that we made to describe the evolution of the scalar field, this is when it starts breaking down. Okay, but there's a particularly interesting case that you can look at is the case of if rho one is equal to 1/2. So you look at equal amplitudes to be in either of the definite energy density values to begin with. This density matrix is totally decoherent. It's just a diagonal matrix. Okay, and so the message I want to take away from this analysis, this is a very extreme case, but even away from this interesting extreme case, decoherence still proceeds, at least over times in which we can trust this master equation approximation. But the interesting thing is that it's not decohering into a basis of definite phi values. It's decohering into a pointer basis that is a superposition of the definite energy density values. Okay, so yeah, that's kind of interesting. It's you might have expected that it would just decohere into configurations of definite stress energy, but it's saying no. For equation of state parameter that's sufficiently negative in a particular scalar field, the gravitational interactions are favoring superpositions of field values. Okay. So, right. These are some interesting observations I've made, which you might have some questions about. So now I'd like to just spend the last 10 minutes or so of this talk discussing some of these observations and discussing some further physics. Okay, so let's come back to the cosmological phase transitions beginning. So first of all, yeah, let's come back to these cosmological phase transitions. So we found with a bit more involved calculation that the decoherence time, so T decoherence goes like 1 over this parameter lambda. So right, it goes like 1 over the temperature times 1 over energy difference squared, which again, in terms of the potential parameters and cosmological parameters we considered before, we see that indeed it goes like m Planck over field mass parameter squared times 1 over root lambda, which is the Hubble time. Okay, so again, just to reiterate this message, decoherence due to interactions with thermal gravitons, it's parametrically longer than the Hubble time, but it is exponentially faster than the instanton time scale that would drive tunneling transitions. All right, so what does this mean? In particular, what does this mean for example, Coleman Delutre transitions, okay? Well, the short answer is I don't know. And I can propose two alternatives, okay? So the first alternative is that this is a mechanism that suppresses vacuum decay, okay? That effectively interaction with thermal gravitons coming from your cosmic horizon acts as a sort of quantum Zeno effect, okay? So it's like, you can imagine that if you started in the false vacuum, while you might tunnel at an exponentially slow rate to the true vacuum, you have this decoherence that's driving interactions at an exponentially faster rate, which keeps you centered at the false vacuum. Okay, and this is the sort of conclusion you would arrive at if you were studying, for example, spin chains that are allowed to interact with thermal baths of photons. Right, so that's one alternative that suppresses vacuum decay. the other alternative is that, well, it enhances vacuum, the rate of vacuum decay, or you may, or this is maybe the mechanism that you should think of that, think of as actually realizing vacuum decay, okay? Now, why might you suspect that this might be the case? Well, we just saw that interactions with gravitons for a pure scalar field, in fact, it favors a it puts you into a pointer state that's a superposition of field values. So you might think that, okay, well, this is priming you for making these vacuum transitions. It's actually favoring that you wind up in wave functions that have support over the false vacuum, over the true vacuum if you start in the false vacuum. And there's furthermore evidence from other gravitational studies, which didn't consider couplings to gravitons, but tried to mock up these sorts of interactions with scalar fields. Okay, so right, so I'm not sure. I think in order to answer this question, one will need to do a bit more sophisticated study than just like a ball of homogeneous scalar fluid. Start looking at, for example, more field modes. Just to be able to more honestly allow field configurations that look like the instanton configurations that allow for tunneling. Okay. Another interesting observation I'd like to make is that if you don't have quantum mechanical gravitons, you don't have decoherence. So if you'll recall from a few slides ago, the asymptotic decoherence is caused by this asymptotic behavior of this noise kernel, n of t, okay, which tends to just some constant, value, okay? But if instead you had at the beginning of the day started with just the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, you would find that this integrated noise kernel would tend to some, at very large times, would tend to some expression that is suppressed by a factor of 1/T, so ultimately decays away to zero, which at the end of the day would mean that, well, okay, you would still have a decay of decoherence, but it would only be a linear decay of decoherence, not rather than an exponential decay of decoherence. So meaning that, well, okay, with classical gravitons, you have a much slower rate of decoherence. Right. And now, so why I harped a little bit on this tensor structure that was appearing in the master equation is because you can extract some interesting physics from that tensor structure, okay? So recall that the rate at which gravitational decoherence proceeds is set by this parameter lambda, okay? Which, and the sign of which is set by this factor f of w, which came from the tensor structure in the master equation, okay? So this f of w, this 2 w mu w nu minus w mu w nu nu, it came from this tensor structure involving the stress energy tensor at the beginning of the day, which I can rewrite in a very useful and suggestive form as two copies of the stress energy tensor contracted with the graviton propagator numerator, okay? Where this graviton propagator numerator, it appears in the Shaolin-Lemon form, the exact propagator for spin 2-2-point functions. And ultimately it cropped up in our master equation because we were integrating over these spin 2 gravitons in order to write down this effective evolution for the scalar field, okay? So why in particular I identify this tensor structure depending on the stress energy tensor for the scalar field and the graviton propagator numerator for the gravitons is that now we can play games where we change up, where we just change up different stress energy tensors and different propagator numerators, okay? So now we can ask, well, okay, well, what about other tensor structures? What if instead of having a bath of gravitons, we had a scalar bath, okay? So suppose we had some scalar bath where coupled to our scalar field. In this case, our interaction term in the initial action, it would now just look like there'd be some coupling y. We have our scalar field phi, and we could just couple it to this scalar bath sigma that we put into a thermal distribution, okay? In this case, the propagator numerator for a scalar field is very simple, it's just one, which at the end of the day would mean that this tensor structure coming from the stress energy tensor ends up just being replaced by two times, it ends up being replaced with two times the scalar field phi squared, which notice this is always greater than zero. So remember, this term is the term that was determining whether you decohere into definite field values or not. So if you couple to a scalar field math, what this is telling you is that, okay, well, you'll always decohere into a basis of definite field values. So this phenomenon of decohering into superpositions of different field values is very much specific to the fact that the bath is a spin 2 bath of gravitons. We could play some other games. We could say, okay, well, what about instead, let's couple to gravitons again, but what if we now couple to charged matter, electromagnetically charged matter? So to that end, we could just take that same stressor, that same tensor structure, but let's plug in the Maxwell stress energy tensor. In which case, you find that that tensor structure boils down to the following expression, okay, which you'll note is manifestly greater than or equal to zero, meaning that, again, you will almost always decohere into into a basis of definite electromagnetic charge, okay? Why I say almost always is because there are some examples where this can vanish. For example, a coherent plane wave, where that term vanishes. So what that means is that, okay, well, sure, gravitational interactions will cause like superpositions of charge to decohere, but gravity doesn't act like a prism. It's not going to take some coherent plane wave and split it into its individual spectral components. Okay. Or we could do both at the same time. We could, for example, let's consider an electromagnetic current coupled to a photon bath instead of a gravitational bath. Okay. So in this case, the interaction Hamiltonian now just looks like you have your electromagnetic potential of the photon bath coupled to some electromagnetic current, all right? The propagator numerator for photon bath is now just the background metric, g mu. And you find that the tensor structure in this case, if you run through calculation, ends up just being equal to minus 2, then j mu, the electromagnetic current, electromagnetic current squared. Which, if we suppose that this electromagnetic current is just given by some current density times the forward velocity, well then causality or normalization of the forward velocity means that this j mu will be negative. So again, this thing you wind up with a manifestly positive, parameter setting your decoherence rate. So again, it's saying this will cause you to always decohere into a basis of definite charge configurations. Right. And all right, so we're getting towards the end of the talk. So if you'll allow me to now just be very loose and amuse a little bit because it's fun, what about maybe experimental consequences, okay? So you'll recall that this fast asymptotic decoherence rate, it relies on Bose-Einstein graviton statistics. So in principle, well, could we check that gravity is indeed quantized by looking for whether or not there is decoherence? So like if you didn't see decoherence at a fast enough rate, in principle, that means that these gravitons aren't obeying Bose-Einstein statistics. Well, okay, this is very rough and very hand-wavy, but I can't resist but saying it because it's kind of fun to think about. But anyways, that's just as a very rough estimate of, like, you know, what are the time scales and energies that you have to think about. If you just consider some system and atoms, atomic mass A, total mass M, and just very roughly just plug this into the right energetic parameters, in some meaningful set of units, the rough timescale for decoherence is 1 Kelvin per T, where T is the temperature of your graviton bath, times 1 nanogram per mass of your system, characteristic mass of your system squared, times about 14 milliseconds. So, if you have like a graviton bath about 1 Kelvin, so kind of like coming from order of the CMB, masses of order a nanogram and superposition, you'd have to wait about 14, you have to be able to keep it coherent for longer than 14 milliseconds to investigate gravitational decoherence. Anyways, this is not super meaningful, very rough, just more to kind of tickle your fancy and generate intrigue. But that's more or less all I want to say. So on that note, I'll just end with a summary of what I discussed in this talk. So remember, the starting point, overall picture is that if you have a positive cosmological constant, this source is a thermal bath of gravitons. Gravitational interactions, they're universal in their coupling, and you can't screen them, which means that gravitational interactions with gravitons provide a floor for the decoherence rate in any physical process. And in particular, I spent a lot of this talk arguing that decoherence due to gravitational interactions happens faster than cosmological tunneling processes. All right. The concrete calculation that we did was looking at a cosmological homogeneous two-level system. So just a Hilbert space, which looks like a Hilbert space of a bunch of gravitons, and then the span of two states of definite cosmological fluid energy density. And we found some interesting physics from this calculation, okay? That the pointer basis depends on the equation of state parameter, that decoherence into a basis of definite field versus a basis of mixed field values relies on graviton, or in other words, having a spin 2 bath, and fast decoherence really relies on having Bose-Einstein statistics. And so some questions I'd then like to pose, or some questions that are lingering or would be good avenues for some future work is, well, okay, what does this mean for vacuum decay? Does this really, does it enhance or does it suppress the rate of vacuum decay if you have a false and true vacuum? To answer that, you probably would need to look at some more elaborate, richer models. So for example, models where you include more scalar field modes, or you look at a full curved space-time background instead of just this asymptotic, this approximately flat background. And well, okay, it's tantalizing to think about, but you'd have to think about it carefully. I don't know, is there a possibility of doing some laboratory experiments that to look for gravitational decoherence? I don't know, but could be fun to think about. So I'll, on that note, I'll end, and yeah, if there's further questions, please feel free. Thanks.
Thank you. I guess we had a few questions earlier. Did anybody want to ask any final questions, either here or online?
Yeah, I have a quick question regarding the vacuum decay. So there's really no significant distinction between the two cases, like the Hawking, was it Hawking-Moss? And the Coleman-Deluca case when it comes to decoherence, right?
Yeah, correct. I mean, yeah. Both processes are morally tunneling processes.
Okay.
That are gonna proceed by some exponentially suppressed instanton. But for this kind of like this ball of cosmological fluid model, it's probably better to think of Coleman-Deluca transitions, because it's just a bit closer physically to how a Coleman-Deluca transition would proceed, where you have some cosmology that's sitting at the higher potential, and you nucleate a bubble of the lower potential false vacuum, which then expands the bubble, then the wall of the bubble expands at speed of, essentially the speed of light.
Okay.
And so this cosmological fluid ball model, you should think of that as modeling like, okay, being in a configuration where you're in the superposition of having a region of the false vacuum and right, an amplitude for there being the false vacuum and also an amplitude for there being this like bubble of the true vacuum sitting there that's about to nucleate.
Okay.
Yeah. But again, it is very much a toy model just because like, well, I mean, like kind of the very honest thing to do would be to have a Hilbert space for your scalar field sector, which does include states that have this like thin wall bubble configuration in it. So you really could talk about having like really an amplitude for homogeneous false vacuum and an amplitude for inhomogeneous thin wall bubble that you're about, that's driving the Coleman-Deluca tunneling process.
Can you say again why you said the decoherence could either enhance or suppress the decay? I didn't quite catch it. Naively, I would assume it would just suppress it. Can you explain that just quickly? Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So the suppression thing. So again, that intuition is quantum Zeno effect. That well, okay, on exponentially long time scales, you make this transition from false vacuum to true vacuum, but on these polynomial time scales. If you just keep interacting with this gravitational field, that's going to disrupt these exponentially long timescale tunneling processes. Right. So again, it's like quantum Zeno like thing, where it's like if you have some spin in a magnetic field where it starts processing, if you keep measuring it really really quickly, it's always going to keep aligning you in say the direction you started before it can process into an even superposition of the two. But now why the intuition of why it might actually enhance vacuum decay. So there is this literature which has found that in certain cosmological models, these sorts of a model for this sort of environmental monitoring by super horizon cosmological degrees of freedom increases the rate at which decoherence happens. But crucially in these studies, maybe a caveat I can point out, which is if you go and you look at these papers, everything is modeled as scalar fields. And one of the conclusions we arrived at in the talk was that, well, okay, if we look at instead of coupling to a scalar bath, you're always going to find decoherence into definite field values. So you lose a little bit of physics in this. But the thing, another piece of physics you gain, though, by having gravitons is that, remember, we found that if you have pure scalar field, say, so W is sufficiently negative, these gravitons are favoring decoherence into a basis which consists of a superposition of field, definite field values, okay? And so if in particular, in order to realize a Coleman-Deluccia transition, if you need to in order to actually make the Coleman-Deluccia transition, you have to have some amplitude for you have to have both the background false vacuum and also an amplitude for this bubble configuration, okay? And so this is why I say that a more elaborate model is maybe necessary that goes a bit beyond just the empty scalar field, because so an example where this would drastically change the answer is if, for example, say gravitons actually favored things that look like the thin wall bubble. So like these gravitational interactions actually tend to like put you in a state that looks like you have some large amplitude for the, so you start just pure false vacuum. You would drastically change the answer if the gravitational interactions drove you into a pointer basis where one of the pointer bases has a large amplitude and that basis state is the Coleman-Deluccia instanton. So that was a little bit rambly. Did that
You mean sort of the thing and nucleating two sort of lines up at the pointer basis?
Sorry, what was that?
The like Coleman-Deluccia bubble, you're saying the true vacuum is sort of closer to the pointer basis?
Yeah, so like an example where it would, I'd say this enhances vacuum decay is that, for example, say you started in a state that was, you just had a very large amplitude for just false vacuum. If one of the pointer basis states, if it turns out that one of the pointer basis states was a state that if it took you from this false vacuum and evolved you to a state, okay, sorry, let me start again. So decoherence is going to tend to put you into pointer basis states.
Right, that part
of it. Suppose for a moment that the definite field value basis is not the pointer basis, okay? So if we start in, essentially, let's say a state that's just the false vacuum, that means we're gonna evolve into some superposition of a bunch of the pointer basis states, okay? And now suppose that one of these pointer basis states has a large amplitude for the Coleman-Deluccia bubble. And that means if there's some other interaction that like, I've kind of ignored in this toy model, but suppose there's like some other, say like a nonlinear interaction in the field itself, which then monitors configurations of the field itself. Suddenly now you have a very large amplitude. You've evolved towards a total wave function, which you have branches where there are very large amplitudes for the Coleman-Deluccia bubble transition. So in that sense, I'd say, okay, maybe this could put you into situations where other mechanisms could now drive your could realize your Coleman-Deluccia transitions.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Any last questions? Okay, if not, then let's thank Aiden again.